5 years, 5 versions, and $12,000 later, I present to you my setup going into 2024. I just graduated college and I have my own startup making a new multiplayer VR game and sharing about it on this YouTube channel. I've been doing YouTube for 7 years and saving up everything just to get this stuff, so it's a process. That being said, there is a mix of budget and professional stuff in this setup, but can you really tell which is which? Let's go in order of my most regular items to my most interesting items. And you already saw that folding bed, so I know you stick around for that. My most regular item of this desk setup video is going to be my desk. It's a large, L-shaped desk that I got for free on Facebook Marketplace. It came with some extra shelves and drawers on the top, and I didn't really like them, so I took them off. An L-shaped desk, or a corner desk like this one, comes with some extra challenges, but I think I met them pretty well. The next thing I have to include is my chair, and you should hands down 100% buy this chair. I also have two accessories for it that make it even better to use. It has height adjustment, tilt adjustment, it has a headrest that goes up and down, and it's just durable. But it's also really comfortable. I came from sitting on a $100 Amazon gaming chair that was literal cardboard, and I've tried other chairs too, but the seating and the mesh back are the way to go. The price is only $250 most of the time, sometimes $300 when it's out of sale. And for a few dollars extra, I bought these comfortable armchair cushions and these Easy Glide wheels that are so nice to maneuver. They're especially nicer on carpets, but as you can see, they're only one wheel, so that means that they can maneuver much easier. Onto my custom self-built PC. These are the specs, just go ahead and get yourself newer ones if you're gonna build your own PC. The PC wasn't always part of my setup. I started on a $1,000 MSI gaming laptop, then a $2,000 one, and now this thing. And I love this compared to a laptop because it doesn't scream in my face when I'm just trying to work on it. You know, those fans are pretty loud. The keys on the keyboard also don't get burning hot when I'm just trying to do work. This thing is a quiet background beast. I never hear the fans pick up, and the specs are pretty balanced for my workload. And that thing you see to the left of it is not another PC. It is a UPS, not your postal service, an uninterruptible power supply. It basically turns my PC into a laptop. It has a very large battery in it, and the power goes from the wall to the battery, then the battery power powers my PC and a bunch of things on my desk. So whenever the power shuts off, and where I live it goes off about 15 times a year, everything can stay on for about 15 or 20 more minutes. That way I don't have to lose any progress, and if it's just a flicker, I can continue as normal. And thank you, I'll take all the compliments for my cable management in the comments. I spent 6 hours one day under my desk managing this stuff. This basket from Amazon really helps, and the sleeves as well help with all the wires. One mistake that I see every desk setup video have, even Marcus Brownlee's, is their charging bricks. It's kind of nerdy, and I did way too much research, literally looking at 10 different listings, but I found these charging bricks that actually fast charge my devices. Most phones can charge at a faster speed. I know my 12 all the way to the iPhone 15 can charge at 27 watts and wireless charge at 7.5 watts without the MagSafe. So since this wireless charging stand has two wireless chargers, the input was getting split, meaning that I needed to get something more than 5 or 10 watts. That's why I went with something that was like 45 watts. But read those pesky Amazon diagrams too, because one thing charging out of this is the full wattage. Then you plug two things in, it's less. But I did the research looking at 10 or more listings, and I found these were the best and affordable. So you can find the link to them below the like button. These are my three monitors, and I like how they're set up. I'll tell you more about them in a bit, but they're held up by three different arms. Two of them are now unavailable from Amazon Basics, but they hold up my ultra wide because they're very heavy duty and also go a pretty good height. The third one is an extra tall Vivo single monitor desk mount, and I've actually slid the monitor all the way to the top of it. That one also holds my microphone arm, even though the microphone arm came with another mount. This is my triple monitor everything setup. I've just been piecing this setup together for a long time. I actually bought this one first for $100 to join with my laptop for a dual monitor setup. Then I bought this one second for $200, both from Amazon, and I would recommend buying today. And it was actually like a triple monitor setup with my laptop because this one was horizontal, but then I replaced it with this one, a $1,200 Alienware ultrawide. I've gotta say, I like my ultrawides. While these two are great 1080p monitors, this one even does 200 hertz. This is my no sacrifice everything monitor. For someone who's making videos, making games, even editing photos and playing games, it's a 34-inch QD Quantum Dot OLED from Alienware, and it does not sacrifice anywhere on the spec sheet. It is 1440p, does up to 175 hertz. It does incredible 10-bit HDR with a peak nit brightness of 1000 nits. Also, the color accuracy is 99.8% or something crazy, which is something you only get on monitors $1,000 to $10,000. Now, let me tell you how I use this ridiculous setup for productivity. I don't like to look up to this top monitor very much, so I usually put something passive like the YouTube music app or maybe a YouTube video. Over here on my vertical ultra wide, I usually have the to-do list here at the top. It's called the Legend app, and it lets me make a lot of nice lists for both PC and mobile. And coming down here, we have the Sticky Notes app, which is a downloaded app default on Windows. Honestly, usually I'm writing out what I'm just thinking in the moment, my train of thought of what the problems are and what the solutions are, because video game design is often an engineering problem, so I need to write out what I'm thinking. And down here at the bottom, I could put anything. I usually swap all these around actually, but as you can see, I have OBS open right now, and it actually displays my ultra-wide, you know, recording pretty nicely. Now for the main ultrawide. You can already see that it displays Unity very nicely with all the inspector windows and everything that I want open. This is the code editor that I use, JetBrains, and it allows me to open two scripts as well as the AI panel right there. Premiere Pro is nice with a large preview window, as well as a very long timeline for all the clips that I'm editing. And then oftentimes I'll have two browser windows open like this. I really like this app called Power Toys for Windows. It's more of a beta app that adds more features to Windows. My favorite use case of it that I use daily is reorganizing my windows. So I can take this window here, and then whenever I right click, I'm going to drag it into a zone that I predefined. So I can make this nice vertical thing in the middle here that's just nice to like read an article or something, or just switch it to one of the left or right zones. And it's for all of my monitors. So that's how I have the perfect size for this YouTube music player up here. And then I have these perfect sizes as well. It's so easy to just drag and drop into. This is my mouse, and you've probably seen just about every other YouTuber use it, but you don't know how I use it. Also, I'm going to show you my brother's newer one, just because it's whiter and cleaner. So did you know this mouse actually has two extra buttons? And they can do some pretty incredible things. Basically, the geniuses at Logitech invented a way to do gestures with a mouse. Obviously, clicking down the button should launch a shortcut, that makes sense. But what if I told you each button does 5 shortcuts? That comes from clicking down the button and going in one of 4 directions, up, down, left, or right. So with the 2 extra programmable buttons, I can do 10 shortcuts. I use my 10 shortcuts pretty often. Some of my shortcuts open specific web pages or specific file path locations, but this has also revolutionized the way I listen to media and music on my PC. By just clicking down the thumb button once, I'm playing or pausing the last played media, whether that's a song or whether that's a YouTube video. And with this nice, seemingly useless side scroll wheel, I control my volume. That is a game changer because I can increase or decrease the volume as quickly or as slowly as I want. And the one that I actually smile using every time is one gesture to put my computer to sleep. So when I click the top gesture button on the mouse and go to the right, the computer is asleep in one stroke. I use the Elgato Wave 3 for my microphone. It's kind of funny to have a $120 microphone paired with a $3,000 camera, but it works. Especially with better and better software tools and AI features, USB microphones are the kings of affordability. Not that I'm using any AI tools, I keep the microphone relatively close to my face and also have a pop filter so that you don't have any plosives. The microphone arm was a little expensive, but it serves my needs well. My room is pretty echoey when the bed is up against the wall, so I did some acoustic treatment to help that. I think the goal is to aim for 5 or 10% coverage of your walls, and since I have higher ceilings, I pretty much just put them all in the ceilings. Otherwise, I haven't put that much around, and it's mostly fine because I just stay pretty close to the microphone.
And I shoot video in the Sony A7 IV, which is a little bit of overkill and definitely a large investment. But I figure I only change cameras about every 5 or 10 years or so. So I figured I'd go ahead and get it. I've installed this quick release plate that has 4 sides, which is nice, so I can put it in different ways. But all I have to do is lift it onto this mount and then click it in with 2 fingers. So now it's clicked in and secure, and I can quickly release it if I wanted to get it. This is a Manfrotto Magic Release Arm, and all I need to do to loosen all of these joints is to unscrew this, and they all loosen. This is the closest I could get to the pole, actually, but it can go out further, like much further away, and it's very customizable that way.
These are the Audio Engine A5 Plus powered desktop speakers. $400 for high-quality studio monitors is a pretty good deal. I need sounds to be accurate in both loudness and balance when I'm making videos or making games. For once, these speakers get better the louder they are. But you don't need such large speakers. I would go with their smaller cousin. All of the lighting on my desk is powered by Philips Hue products. I'm not sure if you can tell, but I actually have 6 light sources on my desk. I have 1 Hue play bar on the left side of my desk, 2 play bars on the back of my main ultrawide monitor, attached with command strips, then 2 bulbs and a lamp I had from my house, and finally the last play bar on the right side of my desk. As you can see when I'm turning these lights on and off, I think I accomplished the best look with just enough product. I bought the 4 playbars used, which saved me some money because they are expensive, and my oldest Hue color bulbs are coming up on 5 years now, so they really do last that rated like 12 or 13 years. Through the app, I can change the colors to be a new lighting scene every day. There's a lot of customization and fun to be had with the Hue app, but the functionality and fun doesn't stop with the Hue app. There's also a free desktop app that adds more functionality. Aside from changing the scenes and brightness from the desktop, you can also sync to music, and my favorite part, syncing the desktop, like to games. So basically, as you're playing any game, or even just using your desktop or watching YouTube videos, the app is taking different points on the screen and taking a color from that. Then it's sending that color to each bulb pretty quickly, and the results are just, well, you can look there for yourself. Two accessories that I have besides the bulbs are the remote and a motion sensor. Now, the remote I use just to change my desk setup, even though I have bulbs in the rest of my room as well. And the motion sensor was a little bit more of a nuanced purchase, but I found a use for it. What I do is put it right outside my door, and every time I pass by it, some lights turn on, a warm, you know, orange, just for 2 minutes, kind of like as a walkway light. And this only happens after sunset. I mean, when they say smart home, they mean a really smart home. In total, I actually have $400 of Philips Hue products on my desk if I bought them new. But you don't have to buy them new. They do plenty of sales and promotionals, or buy them from someone used who didn't fit it in their setups correctly. Before I show you my $1,500 bed frame, let me show you my $15 green screen. This is the second version of a DIY green screen that I made up myself. Basically, it's a $1 9-foot PVC pipe that you can buy from any hardware store. That pipe is resting on some command hooks that are stuck to the wall with command hook strips. And finally, I have this large green screen cheap fabric from Amazon. But recently I had a family member sew a seam into it so that it creates a loop that the pipe can go through. And it's plenty collapsible. All I have to do is take down the pipe and just lay it on the floor or fold it up if I want to. Now for the pinnacle of my setup, something that lets me play much more limitless VR, my Murphy bed. This is something that I've been eyeing for years, and while I already do have a pretty large room, it's kind of an awkward long L shape, so it doesn't mean I have a good square space to play VR in. I'm also making these YouTube videos, and I don't want my bed in the background. So this $1,500 DIY kit from Breda Beds solved that problem. This is actually the very stripped down version. It doesn't have lights or like a desk or couch that goes with it. I thought I could do it all in one Saturday, but it ended up taking me until Monday. I didn't need a lot of tools outside of what was in a small toolbox, and I borrowed my family member's stud finder and a power drill. You do have to get a thinner 11-inch mattress, and it's actually the same mattress I was using anyways. It also looks a little bit low for a bed, but it's the perfect height to actually just sit on in the middle of the day. So now I enjoy playing VR and having plenty of space. It's been a long process, but now that I've got my setup figured out, I can't wait to make videos. Go ahead and watch one of the next ones that popped up on your screen.